You know, I've had the honor of being involved in law enforcement my entire adult life. And I can tell you, I'm blessed to be here today at this ribbon-cutting ceremony, because when Andy came to speak with me more than a year ago today, what he said he wanted to do seemed like a wonderful dream, but, you know, I don't see many people bring dreams to reality. But today I'm seeing dreams being brought to reality. And here's what I know. Drugs are destructive. It's an absolute destructive addiction. If you don't believe me, we got some subject matter experts here. Okay, they can tell you that. But it all starts when we're kids, you know, we're bulletproof when we're kids, right? And especially guys, you know, we're full of testosterone, we're gonna live forever, we can leap tall mountains, and all of a sudden we find out that, wow, drugs are real and drugs are in control and we're not in control any longer. And it's getting worse. It's getting worse. You know, I've worked in this my entire adult life trying to, and worked a lot in my career supervising organized crime, narcotics and organized crime. We took off drug traffickers, the Medellin cartel, the Cali cartel back in the day, plane loads of dope coming into the United States. And today, meth flows across the southern border almost unobstructed. So in 2020, Polk County saw a 39% increase in drug-related deaths. 39%. We went from 140 drug deaths in 2019 to 195 in 2020. Now I want you to think about that for a minute. There's 365 days, and more than one person every other day in this county alone died from a drug overdose. That doesn't count the people that got addicted. That doesn't count the people that were already addicted. That counts the people who just died. But it's not just a Polk County problem. It's a problem across this nation. The number of drug-related deaths have steadily increased year to year. In 2019, across this nation, 70,630 people died from drug overdose. In 2020, nationwide, there was a 30% increase to 92,000 people who died, the most ever recorded in a 12-month period. And then in 2021, another record high was set in that 12-month period, where 100,000 people died from drug overdose. It's the first time in history that's occurred. You know, folks, that's not good statistics. But you know, it's not just statistics. You know, you hear me talk about numbers, but for every individual, that's someone's mom, their dad, your sister, their brother, their uncle, their aunt, their best friends. And it shocks me. We have to win people back before they die.
Amen.
You know, when I go around the community, they say, you like to put people in jail that violate the law. And I said, I sure do. I enjoy it. You know, people go to bed at night, they count sheep to go to sleep. I count bookends at the county jail. But what's the purpose in that? The purpose in that is to make sure that we get those people help, whether they want it or not. But there's not enough opportunities in our system to do that. Why do we want them to get help? Not that I want to see them go to prison for 5, 10, 15, 20, 25 years. I just want them to stop their addiction or stop selling drugs and addicting other people. I just want people to live a better quality of life. And nothing good just happens by itself. And when bad things happen, somebody helps that happen as well. So when I look at Refuge on the Ridge, it's Christian based. It's a place where folks can come here with previous addictions or addictions, and they can become clean. But here's what I've learned throughout my career. Now, folks, I not only worked in law enforcement, I not only went and got all my education, I taught for 23 years as an adjunct. And you put all the statistics aside until God changes your heart.
Yeah.
Nothing changes.
Yeah.
You know, God doesn't change your heart until you want to change your heart. You see, God gives us free will. And at the end of the day, that's why there has to be a healing process. And it has to be through an authentic relationship with Jesus.
Okay.
We've got to understand that we're not bulletproof, that this stuff's eventually going to kill us, that life is hard and work is hard, and selling drugs and using drugs is not going to get you to where you want to be. But we take a deeper dive in our inner soul and our healing. We find and deal with deep-seated traumas and root causes, which led to the substance abuse in the first place. We know that Refuge on the Ridge is going to help these men with legal, financial, spiritual, relational destruction that's in their life right now. And you know what? There has to be responsibility and accountability. God demands that. Understand, drug addiction is at an epidemic in this country. And it's a rampant problem. We not only see it destroy families, or see the person who uses the drugs destroyed, but the families. Usually the family that surrounds the person suffers the most. The one on drugs at least gets a buzz or a high and gets away from it for a period of time. But the family doesn't. And mama doesn't. And mama doesn't ever quit loving. I'm just telling you that. Thank God for mama. Right? So I pray for the godly men who lead their families in a righteous path. And I pray for these men every day that when I get up in the morning, that we can make a positive difference or do something that makes them make a positive difference in their life. You know, I understand one thing, that a child cannot live without a mother. But a child cannot grow without a father.
That's right, yep.
And these men have got to be fathers, and they've got to set positive examples. And mothers have got to be mothers and set positive examples. I wish God's greatest blessings on everyone and on this program. And I can tell you this, we helped make this possible. I'm told it's about $25,000. Vance Monroe, Major Monroe, there he is. He was over there. He's moved on. Andrea. Andrea's my executive director. Vance is, are you the chair of the board right now, or are you on the board?
I'm on the board.
You're on the board. We make good things happen in the community. So how do we get money? It's not government money. The money we put into this is people in the community who donate money to our charity. Why do they donate money to our charity? Because I promised them that we're going to use that money that they donate to my charity to make the world better.
Yeah.
And they go, well, how do you do that? The vast majority of the money we donate is to places like Refuge on the Ridge. It's to homes. Our top priority is, look at the population that comes through the jail. Look at the population that ends up in prison. Look at those folks and tell me what their needs are and who's willing to help them so they don't come back to jail. And that's who our charity helps. The overwhelming majority of the money. I just talked to Andy a minute ago, and the real boss is Andrea here, who's my executive director. She's the number three person in the organization at the sheriff's office. And we're going to make more good things happen here because of you guys. If you're willing to say, I want to change and come here, and you're willing to work to do that, the Sheriff's Charity is going to provide other infrastructure to help you along the way. So at the end of the day, understand that we're safe in this community, and we feel safe in this community, and we're going to make sure everybody's safe and feels safe in this community. We want to do that in partnership with everyone. You know, my greatest blessing for me and for this community, and for this community, is if we could put the county jail out of business.
Come on.
Okay? Amen.
So that we don't have to put anybody else in jail. So help us make that possible. And for the donors, for Ms. Yana, Bob Elliott, certainly my buddy Vic, and all the other donors and members of this board here, know that we're your partner. And for you guys that are in the program, you make me smile today, because you're here, and that's a success story to us. Yeah. And we never get to see you. We never get to see the ones that do good and go into society. The only ones we see are the ones that are on the wheel, that go, come back, come back, come back. But my goodness, it's exciting at the thought of never seeing y'all again. The next time I see you, I want you out building a dock in the community at your newfound business. I'll tell one last story. There was a kid that went to school with my boys. He grew up at our house. Well, he got out of high school and he got into selling heroin. He was making big money. And so he decided he would go into private industry, and I decided I'd arrest him. So my detectives put him in jail. This is a kid that grew up with my kid. So he went to prison. He got out of prison. He went through a rehab program, and he started a lawn care business with a person that was mowing my yard, sold out to him. So he came to the house the first day, and my wife was there. Now this is a guy who's been in prison, selling heroin, was just a mess. He looked at my wife and he said, "Miss Judd," he said, "I understand that you, Mr. Judd, don't want me here." And she looked at him and put that hand over him, like mamas did. He said, "Son, you were welcome here when you were a kid, and you're welcome to work here for me as long as you behave. And if you don't, you got to get off my property. So what's it going to be?" He said, "Ma'am, you'll never have a problem with me." And she talked to him like he was that 16-year-old kid, not like that 40-year-old kid. But you know what? He still mows the yard. He's a great guy. And he's making a lot of money. He could have done that 15 or 20 years ago. But he's making a lot of money. But you got to work. And you got to get your heart right. I wish God's greatest blessings on all of you. And we look forward to seeing you soon. Take care.